beautiful prelude for our service. She does a great job setting the tone. I'm glad to welcome you on this holiday weekend. I hope you have a great holiday. It is festival time, if you did not know. So Kylie and Audrey, can you come help me? Okay. Make sure everybody gets a couple of these. All right, Audrey, you go this side. Who else is here today? Jackson, you can come do the balcony. We'll let the big boy do the balcony. These are tickets for the show, and there's a bunch more up here. Tickets are free. You want to go to the balcony? Who else is here that's old enough to... Hey, Jack Lincoln, come over here. Help me get rid of tickets, will you? Let's go to the back and start. If you can say no to these children, your heart is harder than anybody I've ever met. We want you to take these tickets and get the word out about the show. Remember, it's next Friday at 8 p.m., Saturday at 1:30 and 3, and next Sunday morning, we turn a show into a worship service. And that's for folks who don't want to get out into the festival. So take all you need. We've got more. This is how we invite folks to come join us. Of course, the sign-up sheets for the festival is downstairs in the Welcome Center. There's a board, all the different things that we have going on. You don't have to be a member. We will take you. We need volunteers. And it's fun. And it's going to be, I looked at the forecast, it's going to be 72, low humidity, sunny. It's going to be a perfect weekend. All weekend. It's just going to be, it's going to be beautiful. So, help us to get the word out. Now, right after festival, the 21st, I think starting the 21st of September, we're doing a new church directory. We need you in it. Now, even if you don't want your free 8x10, if you sit for the picture, you will get a free book, a free directory. But more than that, it's a chance for other people to get to know you and you to get to know them. It's been 3 years since we've done a new church directory. And so, Margie, where are you? Margie will be down in the Welcome Center at the table, and she'll get you signed up. It's from 2 to 9, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and I think 9 to 2 on Saturday, something like that. Now, if you're going to be out of town, there is a way. And Westport Road Baptist is having a photo shoot near our time, and I'll give you the codes that you can go on, and you can actually go to Westport Road and have your picture taken there. Thank you, sweetie. And you can, you'll be able to, it'll transfer back to our book. So we really, really want you in there. Today is a great day of worship. Every year on the Sunday before festival, I always have the same theme and for worship. And the theme for worship today is, thank you, Link, is a church without walls. It is our church slogan. And nothing else we do in the year gives us the opportunity to live that out like festival this coming weekend. Let's start, let's stand and greet each other and welcome each other to worship today.
Thank you. giving our auction announcement this morning.
Festival,
yes. Our festival. That's what's next weekend. So when everybody has taken a seat, then I will turn it over to Kelly.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I know you're not used to seeing me up here for announcements, and there's a very good reason why. Public speaking has never been my strong suit. I get really nervous, my hands start shaking, even my voice can start quivering. But when I'm on stage, all of that goes away. The lights, the microphone, the makeup, set design and costumes all help me morph from a shy preschool teacher to someone completely different.
Amen.
So if you'll just excuse me for 1 second. Hi, I'm Wanda. Wanda Wonderful. Oh, you've heard of me. I work downtown at the Uptown Club. Well, anyway, I'm here today to talk to you about our brand new show, which will be celebrating its opening night this Friday night at the Uptown Club. It's called The Big Picture. I don't know how big a picture has to be for all of us to fit into it, but we're gonna try. Now, a long time ago, I used to be just a chorus girl. Too shy to get out in front of people and sing and dance, but I Charlestoned my way to the top, and now I'm a star. Jim, my manager, that we need a brand new marquee outside that has my name in real big letters with lots of twinkly lights all around. It'll read, Wanda Waterfall, the star of stars, the greatest actress since sliced bread! And personally, I don't really see what all the fuss is about. She's not even in the union! Anyways, back to the show. Make sure you don't miss your chance to see the show next Friday night at 8, Saturday at 1:30 and 3, and Sunday morning during church. Now, we're always looking for more people to be involved in the show next year, just so long as you don't take my part. And don't forget to volunteer to help out in our children's booth or our soda shop. T-shirts and hats are also available for purchase. We want to fill this festival with a sea of pink shirts and hats. And Jim, you let me know when that marquee is ready. And see.
That was amazing. Kelly is one of the few who have been in every one except one. You went away to school for a semester. And she was in the very, very first one and was in a girl from Greece. Not Greece the country, the movie. Greece the musical. Thank you, Kelly. What a great testimony. It's time to begin our worship, and I'm going to invite you to open your heart to the Lord. And as I lead us in prayer, this is really a time to put aside all the events of this next coming week or what you're doing today or tomorrow, and to really come to the Lord in this moment. And so, as we pray, I want to encourage you just to take some good deep breaths. Sit back in your pew a little bit. Don't go to sleep. But come into this moment. And realize that we are coming to worship the Lord of the universe. Pray with me. O Lord and God, and Father. We are here at your invitation because you sought us and found us and called us by our names and brought us to you and gave us a way to become your children. So how can we not worship you this morning? Through our music, through our prayers, through our tithes. This is our worship, O God. But worship is not just what we do in this room. We worship you through our daily lives. And so my prayer is that through the scripture today, and through the music, and the message, that you will chisel away at those parts of our lives that are not yet fully redeemed. And that we will come to know you, O God, not just while we're here, but in every moment of every day. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
We have lost as we look down the road where song to call us into worship this morning. As we cry out, the dry bones will come alive. This is your opportunity now, our opportunity together corporately as a church family to offer our praises to God. Will you stand with us as we sing?
Jesus, you alone are worthy, and I lift my voice to you. Jesus, you alone are worthy, I know.
One of our greatest privileges is to come to the Lord in prayer. First John, it says, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. This morning we're lifting up Linda Easley in the death of her husband. It was a beautiful funeral service yesterday. Many wanted to stand and give a tribute to Bill and Linda. You were very blessed. And of course, that's Philip's stepdad. And we've got Philip and Cindy home from the frozen tundra today. And it's always good. This is the circumstance that brings you home, but we're always glad to have you back in worship with us. Jim Casey is at home recovering, is having some much better days post-surgery. And Arlo's Bray's sister, Angela, died very unexpectedly down in E-Town this past week, and I know that we lift her up in prayer. Now, after we bow our heads, I'm going to pause, and I'm going to ask you, give you the opportunity to say a name out loud. If you overlap somebody else, that's okay. We're just calling the names of our prayer needs out to the Lord. And then after a few moments, I'll lead us in our joint prayer. Let's pray together.
Dick Shaw,
Shirley Elder,
Danny Green,
Barbara Smith,
Gary
White,
Carol Ann Thompson, Alice McGuire, Jerry Young,
Whitney Boley,
Shirley Hood.
Oh Lord, all of these that we have spoken publicly, there are hundreds more that we keep in our hearts. We lift these all to you and ask you to hear our prayers for our brothers and sisters. When one suffers, all of us suffer. When one grieves, all of us grieve. When one rejoices, all of us rejoice. So we lift these prayers to you, O God, asking that you, in your gracious wisdom, would hear our prayers and answer according to your will. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. It's time for the children's sermon and kids. Miss Linda Vaughn is going to meet you right down here. Linda, you go on this side, I'll bet. Kids, right up here. And Miss Linda is going to meet you. Brother David's on vacation today.
Not enough to share with everybody.
But you know what? Five crackers and two cookies reminds me of a story in the Bible. Does anybody know what I'm thinking about? No? Five loaves of bread and two fish. That's right. The Bible tells us in John, and a couple of Matthew, I believe, it tells us about a story about Jesus and the disciples. They'd been out on a boat, and they had gotten very tired, and they decided that they wanted to rest. So they rowed the boat up to the land, and they got out, and when they got there, all these people were waiting to meet Jesus, because they heard the stories about Jesus, and they wanted to hear about his stories, and they wanted to have him heal the sick people. So Jesus, he loved all the people. And even though he was so tired and he wanted to rest, he told them that he would tell them stories and that he would heal the sick. And so this went on for a very long time that this was happening. And all of a sudden the disciples came up and said, "Jesus, everybody's getting hungry. What are we going to do?" And they said, "We don't have enough money to go buy for all these people, because there were 5,000 men, and we don't even know how many men and women there were." So he said, "What are we going to do?" And so one of the disciples, Andrew, saw a little boy that had a basket, and it had five loaves of bread and two fish. Well, Jesus already knew what he was going to do, because he knew what he could do with five loaves of bread and two fish. And he said, "Tell all the people to sit on the grass," he said, and he said, "We're going to feed all of them." So they sat down, and Jesus took the bread, and Jesus took the fish, and he looked up to heaven, and he prayed to God, and he asked God to bless the food and bless the people. And do you know what happened? Do you know what happened from that?
Yes.
You want to tell? Let me tell. There was extra pieces. There was so much food that it fed 5,000 plus many more. And then there was even 12 baskets of bread left over that would feed more people. So what can we learn from that story? What can we learn from the little boy and what the little boy did? Can we learn anything from that? The little boy only had the basket of bread and his fish. But that little boy was willing to give that so everybody could be fed.
You should share,
okay. What we can learn from it is this. Even that little boy was an ordinary little boy, just like we are. We're just ordinary people. But when everybody comes together, all kinds of things can happen. And I know you all know what's happening here next weekend, because you all are part of it, right? That's right.
That's part of it.
I know it. I'm watching it all. You're all doing so good at all. And so we know what's happening. And you know what's going to happen? A lot of people in our church are going to come together. And we're going to present a program to people that don't know us, that are going to be out here on our property. And we're all going to use the gifts that God has given to us, whether it's through the Broadway on Main and you all singing, and drama, and the production that you've been on, or those people that work in the soda shop, or those people that work at where we have the Oasis tent, or the people who work in the children's food. They're all going to use their talents that God has given them, just like this little boy. All he had to offer were the fish and the bread, but he gave, and that's what we're going to be doing. And my personal favorite is a float. I like that float. Yeah, I do too. And we've got a lot of good people working on that float. And guess what? You all get to ride on it. You all like that, don't you? Yeah, I know you do. I know. We have to hold on to the handle. So that's that. So what we can learn is that this little boy gave from his heart all that he did. And because he did, many, many people were fed. So all of us that are giving to the community and all the people that walk through the door, you know what they're going to see? They're going to see that God's love shines through us, and that they might come to know God the way we know God. They might come to know Jesus the way we know Jesus. And we'll all work together, and that will happen because we know that amazing things happen when all of us work together for the glory of God. So let us bow our heads and let's thank God. Father, we thank you for our story today about this ordinary little boy just like us that gave his 5 loaves of bread and he gave his fish so that multitudes of people could be fed. And Father, so we ask that you be with our church as we approach this next weekend and help us to reach out to others and let others see that you truly live within us, that we might reach them, Heavenly Father. We thank you for the gifts that you've given us, and we want to give them to you from the bottom of our heart. Of course, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, I've got something for you. Okay? I didn't want you to go without a snack. No, I brought you some fish. Today, so I have my helper with me.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you have given to us. Father, we thank you for the many, many, many blessings that you've given to us day in and day out, Lord. We are grateful to you for all that we have. And Father, now it's our time to get back a portion of the many blessings that you have given to us. Father, I ask that you bless this gift. I ask that you bless the one that has given it. And I ask that you use it to further your kingdom throughout our community here in Middletown. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he had performed on the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover feast was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 8 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and two small fish, but how far will they go among so many?" And Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." And there was plenty of grass in that place. And the men sat down, about 5,000. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. And he did the same with the fish. And when they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the miraculous sign that Jesus did, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world." Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. This is the word of the Lord. And it's for us today. You may be seated.
Thank you.
week that was a little scary to me. Prior to World War II, the Swiss held 90% of the watch market. By the 1970s, that had cut to 70 to 60%. By 1980s, it was less than 10%. And manufacturing jobs in Swiss watchmaking went from 65,000 to 15,000. Now that wasn't the scary part of the story. Swiss people really don't scare me that much. What changed the equation was the invention of the quartz watch. The Swiss Watch Federation Research Council created the first quartz watch prototype. They were very proud of it, and they took it to a trade show in Switzerland. And the Swiss watchmakers weren't interested at all because they could not imagine a watch that didn't tick. It didn't sound like a watch. Fortune magazine wrote, "The main villain proved to be the inflexibility of the Swiss watchmakers. They refused to adjust to one of the biggest technological changes in the history of timekeeping." So the watchmaker, the quartz watchmaker, took their watch to an international trade fair. And you probably know the rest of the story. Two companies there saw the potential, Seiko and Texas Instruments. And the rest is history. I'll bet there are more than four or five Swiss watches among us this morning. The rest of us are probably wearing some form of quartz or digital watch. It's easy to think that church should always be the way it used to be. Nothing but those good old hymns, sung from a bound book, started by a man in a black suit, accompanied only by piano and organ, a preacher in a white shirt and tie with black socks, women in hats and gloves. Some of you remember the hats and gloves thing. Only men were visible in the service. Now that worked well for the church when the world outside the church looked like the world inside the church. When the church was a reflection inside these walls of what was happening outside these walls. Mothers worked in the home, which meant they were leaders in church ministries through the week. Vacation Bible school was 2 weeks during the day. Now it's 1 week, 5 days in the evening. Daddies worked regular hours and did not come home and check email. Children had school clothes, play clothes, and church clothes. If you remember having those three, raise your hand. See, you're a certain age. Very few of the balcony raised their hand. I had school shoes and church shoes. Men and women had two or three outfits, and they only needed a very small closet to keep it in. Most of you could fill Goodwill by yourself. Because clothing was bought in a haberdashery or a women's dress shop. You didn't go to Walmart and buy three pieces for $50. Everything had to be pressed. I'm even told underwear was pressed. Public schools had no Wednesday night or Sunday events. Now even Christian Academy has Wednesday night and Sunday events. The world outside the church has changed, and so has the world inside the church. What's outside these walls looks very different than it did 50 years ago. And so every church has to make a decision, a philosophical, theological decision. Who are we going to be? In the light of this, in this world we live in, who are we? And I understand the instinct of some churches to say, we are a fortress, and we're going to build tall walls with slits in them where you shoot arrows at people. We're going to surround the church with a moat and fill it with alligators. And when someone comes along who looks like us, and thinks like us, and is a tither, if we're making rules, let's just add it all together. We're going to let the drawbridge down and let them in, and then we'll put them back up. Because it's us against the world. Other ideas of a church are that we're going to be a community club. We're going to be a social club. And we're only going to admit those who look like us and think like us and dress like us. Other idea of a church is that it's an institution that must be protected and defended. And that the loyalty is always first to the institution. And every breath is about keeping the institution alive. How are we going to survive as an institution? But I'd like to think there's another model of a church that we are very familiar with. It says, our doors stay open. And we're going to take a chance that folks who come in these doors are going to be different from us. They're going to look differently. They're going to think differently. In fact, this is a model that we've come to call a church without walls. And if you don't know that it's not our model, then you're a visitor. I realize that that model is very risky. About a year ago, some rules went into change in the federal government, and some folks were sending out emails, you've got to tighten your bylaws. You've got to make sure that you keep out this kind of person. And my reaction to that was I was pretty appalled by that thinking. Can we really be afraid of who's going to come and call ourselves a church? I'm not talking about someone who's going to harm us. That's what our security team is in charge of. I'm talking about the people who come through the doors, who are looking for a family, for hope. And if we are afraid of them, we've just shut the doors and pulled the blinds and said nobody's home. It's like on Halloween leaving a bowl of candy out front and then never answering the door. Say, we're going to give you the candy, but we're not going to talk to you. How can we, as disciples of Jesus, survive in this world? I think there's a secret here in the sixth chapter of John. The story of the feeding of 5,000 holds a key to help us understand who we are to be. It's a wonderful story. The Sea of Galilee is shaped like an upside-down tarp. Not now, but later, open your Bible and look at the outline of the map in the back. It looks like a harp. In fact, at some point it was called the Sea of Kinneret, the Harp Sea. And Jesus spent most of his time on this northwest corner. From Capernaum, over to down to Tiberias, this northwest corner. But the text tells us that Jesus got in a boat and they sailed to the other side of the lake. Now we would say you would go from that side to that side, but that's not how they thought. They went from that side to that side. And there was another Jewish town called Bethsaida. Bethsaida was another one of the fishing villages, but it happened to be blessed with fresh water because that's where the headwaters of the Jordan flow into the Sea of Galilee. As the snow on Mount Hermon melts, the water flows in to just right north of Bethsaida, and it flows then into through Bethsaida and down to the Sea of Galilee. Jesus has gone across, and when he arrives, he sees a horde of people coming to hear him. And like any of us would be, they knew that he had healed the sick, and they want him to do the same thing. It came time to eat. And the closest town is Bethsaida. And so Jesus says to Philip, who is a native, this is his home turf, he's a local, "Philip, why don't you go into Bethsaida and see if you can get us some dinner? And bring enough for 5,000 men and the rest of them, and let's just say there's probably about 12,000 people." And Philip says what every reasonable person says. "I couldn't spend enough money to give everybody a lick of a piece of bread. It would take..." Even if you kind of wonder, maybe they had 8 months' wages in their little purse that Judas carried. And so Philip says, "That's crazy. They just got to go home." And Andrew, whose more famous brother is Simon Peter, but there's some wonderful Andrew stories. You got to wonder if Andrew wasn't the quiet enabler. He was the one who got things done. Simon Peter was the mouth. Andrew made things happen. And Andrew says, and the text doesn't really tell us, did he say it kind of sarcastically, or was there some optimism? Well, there is a boy who has five little barley loaves, little ones, flat. It's the food of the poor. It's not food that middle-class people would eat. It's poor food. And two little fish, which is more like an anchovy paste. And so the little boy's mother had probably given him some of this anchovy paste to spread on his bread, and that was going to be his meal. And Jesus says, "Go get it and bring it to me." And Jesus knew what he was going to do, and he takes that bread and those two little fish, and he blessed them. And he began to pass it around. And everyone got all they could eat. And they had 12 big baskets left over. Now you should hear in that story, John gives us a clue. It was near the Passover. Jesus is giving the people manna in the desert. Just as manna fell from heaven as Moses and the children of Israel were wandering in the desert, so, and the manna fell every day to feed the people for 40 years, Jesus fed them with one little boy's personal sacrifice. This is a sign. One of the things that jump out at us from this wonderful story is the difference in Philip and Andrew. Philip says, "There's nothing to be done." Andrew says, "We do have this little bit. Now, I'm not sure what you can do with it, but we've got it." I want to take you back to 1999. Christy and I came in the first Sunday of November in 1999. It'll be 17 years in about a month, 2 months. And I said to Leslie, one of those first few weeks that we worked together, I said, I've got an idea. I'd like for us to find an annual event that utilizes a large percentage of the congregation using multiple gifts, that becomes a signature event to the community. And I remember us having the conversation. "You got any ideas?" "No." "Who knew?" And it wasn't long. That was in November. The following September was my first festival here at the church. And so Jeanette and Steve put together a fish pond, right? Remember that? And Daryl Elster was working across the street at a computer shop. He was managing a computer store. And Daryl and I had gotten acquainted because he was Brian's scoutmaster. And I found out that Daryl was a seminary graduate, had been on church staff, and I said, I got this idea, let's put together a slideshow. And so during the festival, we had slides on the screen set to patriotic music, Seasons Across America. I'd like to talk to some of those people who were in that first show. And then we started saying, what else could be done? One of the other suckers, volunteers that I was able to ensnare in that very first year was Doug Gaskins. They were brand new in the church too. And Doug's got a marketing background, retail background. I said, I got this idea, I've kind of got a logo in mind, and we'll just use this logo and this thing one time. This will be a one-time deal. This church without walls, we won't. I got this idea, we'll just do it. And we made car trash bags to give away. And visors, plastic uncomfortable visors. And we got started. And it was just a little bit, we probably spent a couple hundred dollars, $200 or $300. The next year, some more folks got on board with the idea for the show, and John Vincent and Roberta and Mark and Laurel were here by then. And we said, what would happen if we put on a little bit bigger show? And John said, can I do indoor fireworks? And like a fool, he said, yes. And there's marks on this carpet right there where the indoor fireworks were on the carpet. And then we thought, maybe we'll not do that next year. We did a show called The Tunnel of Love. And Bennett and Connor and Lindsay and Sabrina and Brittany. Were you a puppy, Lindsay? Oh, you were. It was Sabrina and Brittany before. And they were puppies in a box. And they came out of the box and danced around on stage to the song Puppy Love. And Kelly and Brian and Billy and Emily and Shannon and Lindsay? Elizabeth? Teresa were teeny boppers, 1950s teeny boppers, and they were lip-syncing. We lip-synced to songs. And the next year was the first time we gave the production a name called Broadway on Bay. See, little becomes a whole lot in the Lord's hands. Now we have six opportunities for ministry in this community. We have the Broadway on Main show, and I want to tell you, this is just a very small piece of this set design. Charles McCullen makes these frames, and Roberta and Abby hand paint them. These are not store-bought, rented. These are handmade, because it's cheap, and Roberta knows how to do it cheap. And if you look on the back of that front set, you'll see another year's show on the other side. And behind this curtain is a set you're not going to believe. Of course, if you have a hard time believing the Uptown Club is in a Baptist church, that's and you met the star. And we started playing lip-sync music, and then we went to recorded music. And then for several years, it was some songs recorded, some live, and now we have a live orchestra. And I got to tell you, when I first said to Leslie, what do you think about a live orchestra? She said, I know nothing about conducting instruments. Nothing. And I probably gave her that dumb blank look. Now she conducts and arranges the music and conducts the orchestra. And now, I don't know how many, you ought to see these children in this show. You've never seen anything like it. There's probably 25 kids. Would you guess
There's about 15 to 20.
15 to 20. They look like 40. The kids love this, and some of our children have grown up their entire lives in churches, in a church that's doing live music on the stage, giving them confidence and experience and opportunity. We have a marvelous float, and if you don't think Linda can command an army, you have not seen her in action. But this float, and Charlie and Charles were out there the other day working on it, and every year it's a masterpiece, and you think it's going to come from, it starts with a blank screen. And the children's booth will be out here, and Jim Lewis, Dr. Jim, and Pat Rhodes are in hefty competition with the soda shop about who can retrieve more income. And Charlie's going to be here this week too. Starting on Wednesday, Charlie said, I've just taken off and I'm going to be here to get the playground ready, or everything ready. We do close the playground Friday night and Saturday. There's a couple of reasons why we need to close the playground then, but I'll tell you later. Partly it's because we're afraid people are going to drop their kids off and leave them. Really. And that's the world we live in. We're afraid that a child could get hurt and we wouldn't have a clue where the parents were. We're not being mean, we just don't know what's going to happen. And the Oasis tent used to be out here. Now it's kind of morphed again. It's still the Oasis tent, but now it's going to be a Wi-Fi hotspot and charging station. And then the soda shop is downstairs. And the sixth event is Middletown Market. Because Christine said, that building is sitting empty. I'll tell you, for years I've been in committee meetings, I've said, what could we use Celebration Hall for? And nobody knew what to do with it. One year, Taste of Kentucky tried to do a Kentucky artist thing in there, and people wouldn't come in. Nobody knew about it. But Christine manages that building and has filled it with booths, and we will make a couple of thousand dollars, probably, for the wait. How much? 50. You're going to make that, aren't you? $1,500, $1,200, whatever we make. It's way forward money to pay off the debt. Do you see the parallel between the feeding of the 5,000 and First Baptist Opportunity during the festival? God has given us, put this in our hands. And He's given each of us a little piece of it. None of us have the whole deal. And as each of us bring our part, whether it's performing, cleaning, childcare, catering, stirring up lemonade, sweeping, each of us bring our part. Look what God does to multiply it in this community. There's one other dimension that I want to close with. I read a story this week of a German schoolmaster in the Middle Ages who, whenever he would enter his classroom of unruly boys every morning, he would take off his hat and bow ceremoniously to his students. Odd thing for a teacher to do. And when asked, why would you do that? These are just stinky boys. He said, you never know what one of these boys will one day become. And in fact, one of those boys became Martin Luther, the founder of the Protestant Reformation. We don't know who we will be talking to, opening our doors to, this next weekend. But here's what I do know. Our loaves and fish are in the Master's hand. And what He does with them will be extraordinary. Pray with me. Our Father, In your wisdom, you placed this church on this street in 1925. You gave them the opportunity to buy this old textile mill and girls' school. And you knew that 80 years later, there would be a festival by the city, paid for by the city of Middletown, right in our own parking lot. Oh God, we see this as your gift. And so we respond to this need by bringing our loaves of fish, each of us our part, and place it not in the church's hands, but in your hands, O Lord. Lord, I'm not a bit interested in building an institution, but I am interested in building your church. We pray, O God, that you will help us to be faithful people. I ask you to bless this work. Anoint it, O God. Protect our people who are out working and serving. But as every one of the folks come in for the show or into the tent to recharge their phone battery or to get lemonade or buy a game at the children's booth or see the float in the parade, who walk in through the doors of Celebration Hall, who sit down and eat ice cream, here's my prayer. Anoint this place with your Holy Spirit so that when they walk through this door, they know you are here. And so we offer to you our loaves and fishes. Take it and feed this community. We pray in Christ's name. Our service today concludes with an invitation to you to publicly profess your faith in Christ Jesus. We also open the doors of the church. I don't know how any plainer to tell you our church story than I've done today. And I often say to folks, you really have to go through a festival season to understand First Baptist. That's also a time you meet people you like and people you don't like so much. You know, we get close to each other. But you know who we are. And if the Lord is leading you to place your life here among us, we invite you to welcome you in, to bring your loaves and fishes. I believe that this is where God is working through us in Middletown, and we invite you to be a part of it. I'm going to be standing right here. David's not here to assist today. But I'll be standing right here, and we would welcome you to become part of our church family. Just come down and take my hand. Let's stand together and sing on the table.
Oh,
and new Deacon Chair Don Prong is coming up for just a quick recognition. Let me say to you that Wednesday night, fellowship meal and Bible study will be in the other building because these Broadway on Main people are very noisy up here. And so we will be over there for dinner again. Is there any other word we need?
First of all, acknowledge, as Jim said, ex-chair, Linda Vaughn, and the work that she did last year and will continue to do. She has another year to serve. Linda, I have enjoyed working with you. Your leadership is remarkable, and you are the most energetic person my sister-in-law I have ever met. So thank you so much for your service. Gabe Close, Gary Millsap, and Steve Stratton are leaving council this year. And I want to acknowledge their service and their ministry to this church and to you and to this church. And to those who are coming on board with us as well, Tish Noller has generously agreed to serve at least one more year. And I want you to see who your deacons are for this year as you see us serve, taking up offerings and serving communion. But there are many things you don't see. And I would like for you to give them a little love right now, if you will. Thank you, folks.
And now, would you all stand for the benediction? And Don is going to speak the benediction, and our tradition here is that we join hands and sing our fellowship chorus as we leave. I hope I'll see you Wednesday, but if not, I hope I'll see you Friday or Saturday. Bring somebody with you to enjoy the festival.
Now may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that this church lives true to its Church Without Walls logo and motto. Lord, I pray that your blessing upon this church as we move through this festival week and through this time of very busy visibility. Lord, it is my prayer that we touch at least one person this year who does not know you. Lord, all of these things I pray in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.